Good morning and welcome to First Congregational Church of Bellingham, United Church of Christ. My name is David Weasley. I have the gift and honor of serving as one of the pastors here at First Congregational. It is so good to have you all with us here on our bigger balcony, which is what we call our online worship services in this season of worship at a distance. We know we are joined by our hearts and by our prayers, even across the distance, even across the time. Whenever you are watching this, wherever you're watching this from, we're so glad to have you with us. I have a few announcements as we begin our worship together. The first thing I wanna mention is that I am here by myself in the sanctuary, and so I'm hoping everything goes smoothly. But Larry M is our wonderful tech person for this service, and so thank you for that ministry, Larry. Thank you for everyone else who's supporting us, making this happen on Facebook. The theme of this service is kind of about how God uses failures. So if things go horribly awry, perhaps that will just be a lovely object lesson for all of us in the continuing love and grace and power of our God. If you're here with us in worship today, I want to invite you to fill out our Worship Connect form. If you were here in person, I would invite you to fill out one of these little red folders with like your name and if we should give you a call and that kind of thing. But you're not here in person, so I'm going to invite you instead to go to tiny.cc/worshipconnect, where you can fill out our Worship Connect form. That's a great way to let us know that you're here, and then we can also see who's not making it to worship, to reach out to them to see if they need support with the technology or any other kind of support. So please take a moment to do that sometime today. Speaking of ways to connect, we have a couple of new ways for our middle and high school youth and their families to connect. One of my roles here is supporting our youth program, and I just started a Remind group, which is a service to receive a weekly text message about our youth program. If you're interested in that, if you're a parent or a young person, let me know. And I've also started a Discord server. So if you are in middle or high school, you might even know what that is. It'll be a place where we can hang out, not just during youth group, but over the course of the week. I'll post some questions and we'll do some activities in that online space. If you're interested in that, please let me know as well. There's an opportunity for all kinds of folks to connect online. Many of you are familiar with our Full Circle newsletter. We're not doing that print newsletter in this time of pandemic. Instead, we have the new Full Circle Forum. That's a place where members and friends of First Congregational can gather online to check in with each other, to share about the news of the day, to ask questions of each other. The address is in the bulletin, which should be linked in the comments here. It's also, the bulletin is also on the front page of our website at fccb.net. There's a lot going on these days. There's a lot of ways to get involved. If you have any questions about that, please don't hesitate to reach out to one of the pastoral staff or to the church office. We love to help folks connect with all of the wonderful things that are happening in this strange season. A note about today's worship. It's a communion Sunday. In fact, it's World Communion Sunday. So congregations all over the world are gathering and sharing communion today as a special celebration. We'll do that as well. And part of today's scripture is when Jesus quotes the Psalms. And he says, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. So that's kind of our theme for the service, this idea that the things that we as humans have ruled out, God might want to lift up and put to use. So here's my particular invitation for communion today. You can certainly gather some bread and juice or wine or whatever you have handy for communion, but I want to invite you to include on your communion plate, maybe in addition to the usual stuff, some kind of food that's just hanging around your house that you're really not planning to eat. Please don't eat anything dangerous. Please don't eat anything that would cause you to go outside your dietary restrictions. But for example, I have for my communion today, I have this can of peach nectar from concentrate, which I have never tried, and I don't know if it's delicious or gross. I also have, I don't know if you'll even be able to see this, I have this little package of Smarties, which have been in the bottom of my snack drawer for some years now. I don't know that Smarties change at all if they're 5 years old, but we'll find out during communion today. Because the stone that the builder has rejected has become the cornerstone. And so if you want to include that in your communion ritual today, I'll invite you to rummage around, find some weird food, find something you weren't necessarily planning on eating or drinking, and include that on your special plate today. Finally, and most importantly, I want to say a word of welcome. We always begin worship by saying a special word of welcome, and I'll do that. But today, I also want to give a particular one. Because of the way this format works, I can't see who's here. I can't see you if you're gathering with us live Sunday, October 4th, at a little after 10 a.m. And I certainly can't see you if you're going to watch this and join in this communion service later on. But I have some intuitions about who might be here with us in the room, in the broad and spiritual sense of in the room. And so let me say welcome to you. If this is your first time ever trying out a service at First Congregational Church of Bellingham, maybe your weird friend invited you, maybe you just came across it, maybe you've been thinking about it for a while, but if this is your first time, let me say welcome to you. If you're watching this late at night or very early in the morning, and just the act of being back in church brings tears to your eyes, welcome. If you're a little high or a little drunk as you watch this, welcome. If you're giving this service about 20% of your attention because you've got a bunch of anxiety or you're really depressed or you have like two or three kids that you're running after and you're kind of half watching this or quarter watching this, welcome. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome in this place. You are beloved by God. Amen. As we join worship together, you can look in your bulletin if you have it in front of you. Again, that's linked at fccb.net or in the comments. But you don't need the bulletin for this service, believe it or not. We're going to do our call to worship, and I'll say a line, and then we'll all say a line together. And your response is always, "The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." Let's say that together. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Let's join in our call to worship. When the world tells us that the strong prevail and the weak don't matter, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. When pandemic and crisis break our routines, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. When we have a really solid plan for where all the stones go and don't go, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The parts of us we're not comfortable with, the people we'd rather avoid, the stones that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. God, you call us to worship all our parts and all our brokenness. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Thanks to God. I want to invite anyone who is a child or anyone who is young at heart to kind of snuggle up a little bit closer to the screen. I think I need to, let me just get my materials here for this part of the service. So I've been thinking about this story that, or this scripture that Jesus quotes. You know, we can quote stories about Jesus, and Jesus quoted scripture from the Hebrew Bible all the time. This particular one is from the Psalms. The stone that the builder rejected has become the cornerstone. And I was trying to think, what's a good kind of metaphor for that? Or what's a good image for thinking about that? Whoa! Did you guys see that? I was wondering if I had a friend who could, whoa, it's you. Hi, David. Well, hello, Esmeralda the Bat. It's good to see you. Well, it's good to see you too, Esmeralda the Bat. Thanks for coming to church this morning. Yeah, it's great to be here. Well, I was wondering if there's anything about your experience of a bat that could maybe help us understand the scripture. Oh, yeah. What's the scripture again? Well, so Jesus says the stone that the builder rejected has become the cornerstone. Okay, what's a cornerstone? Well, that's a good question. You see, when you build a building, sometimes you put one block down first in the corner, and that's really important because you want it to be right where you want the corner of the building to start. But there's actually another translation of this, and it says the stone the builder rejected has become the capstone. Do you know what a capstone is? No, will you tell me? Well, yeah, I looked it up this week. A capstone is if you're building an arch, like you can imagine an arch of blocks, there's gonna be one right in the center, and that one keeps it from falling over. That would be a good place to hang upside down and take a nap. Well, that's right, Esmeralda the Bat. That's a good point. And that's called the capstone. So basically, I think it's about, you know, the things that we think are important, maybe we're wrong about. And maybe the things that we think aren't as good, maybe we're wrong about that too.
Well, you know, David.
Yes, Esmeralda the Bat.
Some people aren't very excited about bats.
Is that right?
Yeah, some people are afraid of bats. Some people don't like bats. Some people try to get rid of bats.
Oh my goodness, that's terrible.
It is terrible because there's at least three great things about bats for humans.
Oh, is that right?
Would you like to hear them?
Well, I think you're gonna tell me one way or the other.
That's absolutely right. The first thing is that we eat a lot of insects. Like, do you like getting bit by mosquitoes?
Well, no, Esmeralda the Bat, I actually don't like getting bit by mosquitoes.
Well, yeah, so we keep there from being too many mosquitoes in your yard or in the neighborhood.
Well, that's great.
Do you like plants?
I mean, I like some plants.
Well, did you know that a lot of bats are important pollinators? So they help plants to grow and new plants to get born.
Well, that's great. I didn't actually know that about bats. So thank you for telling me that. So you eat insects and you're good pollinators. And I think you were going to tell me a third great thing about bats.
That's right. The thing about bats that's good for humans besides pollinating and eating insects is we're just really cool.
You're just really cool.
Really cool.
Well, I guess that's hard to argue with. I mean, you fly around, you sleep upside down, you do that cool echolocation where you can see with your ears.
Yeah, it's awesome.
I mean, I can't argue with that, Esmeralda the Bat.
Yeah.
So I guess what I'm hearing from you, Esmeralda, is that sometimes the animals or the creatures that humans think aren't so great actually turn out to be really important. And so maybe when we think about that cornerstone story where Jesus says, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, we could think about the plants and animals that we're not so sure about and maybe take an opportunity to learn about them and see what's great about them.
That sounds great.
Well, thank you, children, for joining me and for joining Esmeralda. And let's say a little prayer. Would that be all right?
Well, sure.
Oh, Esmeralda hangs upside down to pray. Look at that. God, thank you for this day and this chance to be together. God, we thank you for this promise that the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Help us to see the way that the parts of our life, the parts of our creation, the parts of our community that we don't understand, help us to see the ways that they're valuable, the ways that they're life-giving, the ways that they create more love and justice in our community. Help us to always know how much we are loved by you in every part of us, bat, human, and otherwise. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thanks for coming to Time with Children. Let me, okay, bye, Esmeralda. Oh, she's going up to the bell tower. Okay, have fun up there. Don't tell the trustees that she lives in the bell tower. They might not like that. Well, we're going to join together in our first song, which is the first verse of Be Now My Vision. And I need to go get my mandolin to play along with that. This is the nice thing about having a clergy colleague, is there's a little moment in between when you're doing the Time with Children and playing the first hymn. But we're all together in this, and I appreciate that. Please join me in singing if it's yours to sing, or sit quietly and take some deep breaths and let this song be a prayer. Ooh, I'm gonna switch microphones. All right, Larry, can you hear me on this one? Be now my vision, O God of my heart.
Nothing surpasses the love you impart. You, my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, your presence, my life.
Amen. I'm going to invite you to join me now in a time of prayer. God, in this season of crisis, in this season when some have been rejected, in this season when we throw away parts of ourselves or parts of your beloved creation, we pray that you will be with us. We pray that you will lead us in this worship. But more than that, we pray that you will lead us more deeply into your heart. Your heart that is open to all of our prayers. Your heart that is open to all of our hopes and fears. Your heart that holds the promise of new creation, even in the midst of this broken world. God, we pray this week for all of those who are students. We pray for Tina A as she starts a Spanish class. We pray for all of our elementary and preschool and middle school and high school students as they go back to class this month or last month. We pray for our college students, for our graduate students, for everyone who studies and everyone who works in education. God, in this strangest of learning times, may you make ways out of no ways, ways for learning, ways for community across the distance, ways for new ideas and new understanding to break forth in our hearts, in our minds, in our bodies, in our communities. God, we pray for the ongoing pandemic, especially for all of those who are infected with the coronavirus, including our own President Trump. God, we pray for everyone who struggles to find adequate health care, for everyone who doesn't have enough resources, for everyone who must choose between their financial well-being and their physical safety. God, lead us as we continue to build a safer community, a more robust public health system, as we continue in your call to build a world where healthcare is accessible for all. Lead us, God. Bring healing to all who are sick or injured. Be with everyone who is lonely or depressed or walking the hard road of recovery from addiction. God, you say that the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And we pray that you will give us strength as we grapple with that mystery. As we find the courage to look at the parts of ourselves that we'd rather ignore. As we find the love to reach out to the people in our community that we'd rather avoid. As we find the hope to dare to believe your promises, the ones that feel impossible, the ones that feel too beautiful, the ones we're not ready for yet, God. Give us all of these things. And God, hear all of our individual prayers that we pray across time and across distance now together, joined in your spirit of love. God, we offer all these prayers, spoken and unspoken, named and unnameable, in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray like this. Our parent who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you for joining me in this time of prayer. We're about to go over to a moment for mission from one of our Mission and Justice board members. But before we do, Kate is going to invite you to contribute to the Neighbors in Need offering, which we collect as one of the UCC special offerings each year at around this time. And she says a little bit about what that offering supports, but she doesn't mention how to give. So you can give online and just make a note online that it's for Neighbors in Need. You can mail us a check and just write in the memo line that it's for Neighbors in Need, and that will get to the right place. Please hear this word from our Mission and Justice Board, and please give as the Spirit leads you.
Good morning. I'm Kate, and I'm speaking to you today on behalf of the Mission and Justice Board. This Sunday marks the annual Neighbors in Need offering. This special offering supports mission and justice initiatives across the U.S. and abroad. On average, Neighbors in Need collects $1 million, with a third of all donations going to the Council for American Indian Ministries, and two-thirds going to support a variety of justice projects. This year's campaign asks, "How are the children?" Nelson Mandela is famously quoted as saying, "There is no keener revelation of a society's soul than the way in which it treats its children." With 18% of our nation's children living in poverty, 2.5 million children without shelter, 11 million going to bed hungry, 69,000 caged at our southern border, it's fair to say that the children are not well. We owe it to them to do better. Truly, the well-being of the children now will be reflected in the well-being of our collective future. Join me today in giving whatever you can to this year's Neighbors in Need offering. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate, and thank you all for considering how the Spirit is leading you to give in this season. We come now to the time in our service for a reading from Scripture. This is a story and some reflection on that story, or some response to that story from the Gospel of Matthew. And we join the story, we join the broader narrative of the Gospel of Matthew as Jesus is speaking and teaching and healing in Jerusalem in the last days before his arrest and execution. Jesus says, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' When the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes.' Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. For the word of God in scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God. It's our custom at First Congregational Church to have a season where we reflect on stewardship in the month of October. And so this sermon is the first of that little series. And actually, I think I want to pray again as I begin. So join me in prayer. God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, and the actions of my life be acceptable to you, my rock and my redeemer. And God, may all of your people, through me or in spite of me, hear your word for us this morning. Amen. So as I say, this is the beginning of our stewardship time. And sometimes we think of stewardship as being, you know, the time when we consider making a financial pledge to the congregation to support its ministry in the coming year. And that's a lovely thing to do as the Spirit leads you. But I think it can be a gift to think about stewardship more broadly. What is God's call on our lives? What is God's call on all of our resources? Certainly our money, but also our time, our passions, our ideas, the experiences in our life that break our hearts or fill us with hope. All of our resources as human beings, how is God calling them in this strange and troubling season? So we come to this story, this word from Jesus, framed after a parable that is also strange and terrifying, with murder and landowners and fear. It's a chaotic story for a chaotic time. And it's one of the fears I want to invite us to reflect on as we begin this stewardship season, as we pray to see how the Spirit might be leading our resources. I think we're afraid of chaos. I know I am. I think this isn't outside the scope of Scripture. This isn't outside the scope of the Gospels. This isn't outside the scope of this story. The Gospel of Matthew was written late, well, was gathered and written down late in the first century of the Common Era. A time when the Israelites, when the people Israel, were yet again scattered by empire. After a short-lived rebellion, the temple was once again destroyed, and the Jewish people had to once again reimagine what it was to be a person of faith. And the Christian movement comes of age alongside the rabbinic movement in Judaism. And the Christian movement in the first century is almost entirely Jewish to begin. And so it's in this context, it's in this season of chaos and fear and transformation. Because when the center of our faith was the temple, And then that got destroyed. We had to reimagine who we are. We have to reimagine what God's call is for us. We have to think about what we've been centering and what we've been rejecting. For us, there's maybe a similar ontological challenge. Ontological meaning something that gets right at the root of things, the core of our being, the very nature of who we are as human beings, as community, as people of faith, is challenged in this season. And by that I mean, yes, the coronavirus pandemic is terrifying. It is a force of horror and despair and disruption across our entire world. But more than that, we can read the writing on the wall. We can see the signs of the times. We know that climate change is accelerating. And with it will come more seasons of disaster, more seasons of unrest, maybe even more seasons of violence. It's hard to know what humanity will look like in 100 years or 50 years or 30 years. And so we stand at this moment in history where we're not sure how things will change over the next 30 years, but we know that they will radically change. And that kind of change has some chaos in it. But I want to invite us to reflect as those first century Jewish folks had to reflect. What is ours to claim? What is ours to hold on to? What does ministry look like in the midst of chaos? What are the particular gifts we have for our community, for ourselves, for our world? What stories can we treasure? What wisdom can we hold? What creativity can the Spirit summon us up in us? What can we center that we have been rejecting? There's another fear I want to reflect on in this season of stewardship. And it's one that has puzzled me a little bit. I've noticed this thread, this habit at First Congregational Church of Bellingham and at other churches that are a lot like ours. I was thinking about it most recently because I was talking with our creative finance team, the group that's shepherding our stewardship and a campaign this season. And they were talking about how hard it's been over the course of their leadership. Some of them have been in leadership here for decades. They talked about how hard it's been to get people to call folks up and see if they want to pledge. And at first I thought, okay, yeah, well, we're, you know, mostly white, middle-class liberals, and we feel uncomfortable talking about money. That's part of kind of our cultural baggage. But then this interesting thing happened. You know, that same team reached out to some leaders and they said, hey, would you call folks who pledged last year to just thank them for giving? And to me, fascinatingly, they had no trouble finding folks who were willing to call up people and talk to them about money and say, thank you for contributing to the ministry of First Congregational Church of Bellingham with your money. So if we're uncomfortable talking about money, why was it so easy for people to call and say thank you? Maybe that's a more comfortable way of talking about money, but I think there's something else going on. Friends, siblings, beloved of God, it is my conviction that too often in our congregation, too often in our culture, too often in the circles that I travel in anyway, we are afraid to fail. Because y'all, like, if you call somebody up and say thank you for giving, it's really hard to mess that up. I guess you could accidentally not thank them for giving, but I don't think anyone's worried about that. But if you call someone and ask them to consider pledging, well, they might say no. And then where are you? I have seen this congregation make some bold and passionate and daring moves on behalf of the kingdom of God. But I have also seen us sometimes be slow to take those daring moves. And sometimes it's because we're not sure if we're called to them or not. That's the right kind of delay, in my opinion. Discernment takes a while, and that's all good. But sometimes I think there's a part of us as a congregation, sometimes there's a part of me as a person that delays in those daring moves on behalf of the kingdom of God because I think it might not work. Maybe no one will come to this program. Maybe this partnership with a nonprofit won't work out. Maybe people won't like it. Maybe we won't achieve our goals. I don't know where that comes from. I have a little suspicion that many of you, like me, were the kind of young person who really liked getting good grades in school, and so we want to like complete all the assignments. Maybe it's that. Maybe it's the way that capitalism has insidiously infected our ways of deciding what's valuable, where we, you know, the things that succeed are the things we want, the things that fail, those weren't worth trying. I don't know. But I think that fear of failure isn't helping us. I had the gift of doing some improv work a couple of years ago. And we played that game where your character walks on and you say an opening line and then someone hits a bell, ding, and you have to say a different opening line. And I would come with one or two or three lines prepared, but the facilitator would just ding, keep hitting that bell over and over again, ding, ding, and I'd have to keep trying more and more lines. And what I noticed was when I got past my strategy, when I got past my plans, then we got to some really interesting stuff. Some of it was great, some of it was really dumb, but it was rich. There was, how do you say it, fecundity to it. There was a fertileness to it. There was a richness to it in the sense of rich like compost, right? Digging deep to that part of us that's really alive. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. So I say to you, friends, siblings, beloved of God, I think the Spirit wants your worst ideas. I think the Spirit wants those dreams that feel impossible, those hopes that feel too dangerous. I think she wants to get her hands on them. I think she wants to teach you over and over again that your call is to love. And succeeding, that's not the important part. The third fear that I think we run into, that I know I run into whenever I pray about my own discernment for stewardship, for innovating church and sustaining community in this season, is I'm afraid of not being good enough. And I think that's true for our church as well. It's really easy for me, and I think for others of us as well, to think about all the ways that we could do better as a congregation. We could be doing more for the environment. We could be doing more for racial justice. We could be doing more for worship. It's just one white dude in a big empty building. Surely we can do better than that. But friends, siblings, beloved of God, I had the gift of speaking on a panel with some other clergy from LGBTQ welcoming congregations in Bellingham this week. And it reminded me that for all the ways I want to see our church continue to grow in faith, for all the ways I want to see us be more bold and passionate in our pursuit of love and justice, for all of the ways we are not yet the church that God is calling us to be, being on that panel reminded me that we are also already the body of Christ. We are also already a community of love and fellowship and support and boldness and radical invitation and radical welcome. And I will confess to you that sometimes I have been shy about naming who we are. So speaking of things we're afraid of, and speaking of stewardship, I want to invite you right now to take a moment and see who you know that needs to hear this message. See who you know that just might want to be part of this community. See who you know that will be willing to be with you on the phone or on a Zoom call and watch this ridiculous worship service with you. In some ways, it's easier now than it ever has been before to invite your friend to church, because they don't have to live in the same town as you. You can watch this at 2 a.m. Tokyo time. But in this season of disruption, in this season of chaos, in this season of fear, maybe we have some good news for some hurting folks. Maybe we have a little bit of hope or a little bit of wisdom. And certainly, we need the hope and wisdom and love and passion that that friend of yours can bring to us. So take a moment and see who comes to mind. Maybe somebody came to mind right away. Maybe you want to text them right now and say, hey, will you watch this weird video with me? Maybe you just want to say a prayer for them. But I think we fail in our call to stewardship when we don't think about who else in our community, who else in our lives needs the good word of God's welcome. Whether or not my preaching is any good, whether or not our worship is any good, whether our music sounds great or is kind of tinny and awful, that's not the important thing. The important thing is that in a minute, we're going to have communion. And we're going to say, God welcomes everyone to the table of God. Everyone is invited into the good news of God's love. There's no way I can fail at that. It's good news that calls us through chaos. It's good news that tells me that whoever I am, whatever I've done, I'm good enough. I have a call. The Spirit wants my rubbish ideas. The Spirit wants my nervous invitations. The Spirit wants the parts of me that I'm uncomfortable with. She wants it all. She wants to invite us all to join her at her table. Amen. So,
as we gather at your table, as we listen to your word, help us know, O God, your presence. Let our hearts and minds be stirred. Nourish us with sacred story, till we claim it as our own. Teach us through this holy banquet how to make love's victory known. Turn our worship into witness in the sacrament of life. Send us forth to love and serve you, bringing peace where there is strife. Give us, Christ, your great compassion to forgive as you forgave. May we still behold your image in the world you died to save. Gracious Spirit, help us summon other guests to share that feast, where triumphant love will welcome those who blessed and pleased. There no more will envy bind us, nor will pride our peace destroy, as we join with saints and angels to repeat the sounding joy.
Amen. I want to invite you now to a time of communion. So if you already got your bread or your cup or whatever weird food item you have, you had rolling around in the back of your fridge, I want to invite you to gather that now and join with me as we remember and proclaim the good news about God's welcome table. On the night he was arrested, on the night before he was executed, a little while after he told the story about the tenants and the vineyard, a little while after he said that thing about the cornerstone, Jesus got together with his friends. Some of them outcasts and rejects, some of them the center of society. And he ate with them. And in the middle of the meal, he got some bread. I got Smarties here. Whatever you have, all a message of God's love. And as they were eating, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This bread is my body broken for you. Whenever you eat it, remember me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, special cup, and he gave thanks to God, and he poured out some wine, and he said, "This wine is the new covenant of my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, remember me." And so now, across time and space, in churches speaking probably every language in the world, or at least a lot of them, across history, across pandemic, quarantine, we join together. And you'll notice, friends, siblings, beloved of God, that I've got two communion sets on the table this morning, though I've mentioned it's just me here in the building. This one here has been on the table since we all left in March. Didn't feel quite right to use that one yet. So I'm just going to have that one there for now empty as a reminder that this table is here for you and we're gathered. And even the sadness of being physically apart is part of what joins us around this table. But Jesus broke that bread, and Jesus poured that cup. And now in all times and in all places, the fullness of God's love and mercy is poured out and broken for all of us. You are beloved. You are called. This feast is for you. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Join me now in celebrating the feast. Thanks be to God. I want to give everybody time to feast, so I'm going to play that first hymn again.
Be now my vision, O God of my heart. Nothing surpasses the love you
Feel free to continue. Ooh, let me switch mics. Feel free to continue feasting if you still got sweet tarts and peach nectar or bread or wine or whatever you have. It is all evidence of the welcome table of God. But in the midst of your feasting, hear now this sending prayer. God, of those of us who have been rejected, who are now welcomed at your table, send us. God, of those of us who have done the rejecting, who are now welcomed at your table, send us. God, you who hold our fears, our fear of chaos, our fear of not being enough, our fear of failing, send us, afraid, beloved, fed. Send us to bring peace to all of this broken world. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace, everyone. We'll have the postlude, and then we'll keep this feed open if you want to hang out in the comments a little bit. Thanks for being here today.